Now, let us talk to Mr. Rakib Ehsan, because he is actually Dr. Rakib Ehsan, I should say, because he is with the Centre on Radicalisation and Terrorism at the Henry Jackson Society. He's a man with a great deal of views that we agree with here at Talk Radio. And let's hear from him now. Rakib, a very good morning to you.
Morning, Mike. How are you?
Yeah, very well indeed. Thanks very much for joining us. Now, I know that you've been writing a lot over the last few days about this exchange between Priti Patel and the Labour MPs, who basically accused her of not understanding racism. Since then, since her appearance and since her incredible speech, which I thought was incredible, in the House of Commons, where she defended herself, talked about her upbringing, talked about how she had suffered from racism as a young girl in this country, and also talked about how she would not be lectured by the Labour Party on whether she was understanding or not of racism. I mean, it's an incredible battle that's being fought out here. Keir Starmer has since written another letter. He seems to love writing letters. Somebody pointed out the other day, he's a former lawyer, so he probably thinks he's getting paid every time he writes a letter. He gets $5,000, you know. But basically, he's written another letter sort of haranguing Priti Patel. Tell us what you make of it all.
Well, I think that the letter from... a letter which was signed by a number of Labour MPs and was authored by Naz Shah, who is the Shadow Minister of Community Cohesion.
Yes.
I thought ultimately what this letter did, Mike, I thought it struck a very poor tone. I think it essentially trivialised the experiences of racism experienced by the Home Secretary, which she explained these experiences in the House of Commons. And the reality of the matter is... what we saw in the House of Commons was a Conservative Home Secretary essentially being hectored into talking about her personal experiences of racism. And then Labour have essentially doubled down with this letter by essentially trivialising her own personal experiences. And I think it's very unhelpful. And the term gaslight was actually used in the letter, which I think is deeply inappropriate in this context.
Yes, exactly right. And why is it, do you think, that the left can't stand the fact that the Tory party, particularly now, has a great number of members of various ethnic minorities in it? We had Sajid Javid, who was the Chancellor. We got Priti Patel. Mm. You know, there's all manner of different colours and hues of skin in the Tory party now, and they can't seem to handle it.
Well, there was a time where much of the left, they used to celebrate ethnic minority success, Mike. High-achieving individuals with a non-white racial background. The issue we have here is that there are individuals which are considered to be an inconvenience now for the left. I'm mainly talking about high-achieving non-white individuals who firmly reject racial identity politics. They may be traditional-minded, but their core values may be associated with personal responsibility, self-sufficiency, individual initiative. And that does pose a fundamental threat to the left's precious white privilege narratives. And it's very sad to see, from, you know, myself personally, I traditionally identify with the left. And it is a real problem now where there are forms of racism which is being directed towards ethnic minority individuals purely because they may have a different view on issues such as immigration, Brexit, counter-terrorism. And I think it's a deeply sinister form of racism to suggest that people have to think a certain way on a wide range of public policy issues purely on the grounds of their racial background.
Yes, that's exactly right. And why has race suddenly become such a thing? Because obviously we've been talking this morning to Nigel Farage. We've been talking for the best part of the last 2 weeks about this movement called Black Lives Matter, which seems to have kind of emerged out of nowhere following the murder of the black man in Minneapolis at the hands of the police. You know, up until this moment, we didn't really know much about them.
Well, I think that what we are witnessing, Mike, is that we have radical leftist activists in the UK, they're looking to aggressively import US-style culture wars into British society. Now, I've written a fair bit about this over the last couple of weeks. The reality of the matter is, Mike, you cannot compare British society with American society. They're very clear fundamental differences. US society, in comparison, afflicted badly by, you know, what I would consider to be hyper materialism, aggressive form of individualism, deeply bitter race relations. And on top of that, you have that broader culture of law enforcement brutality. that is simply not the case here in the UK. And it's very interesting when such activists, anti-racist activists, when they're presented with research and survey data, which very much suggests that Britain, even though there are issues surrounding racial discrimination, race relations can be improved in the UK. But when they're presented with data which shows that UK on an international level is one of the most tolerant places to live, that the reality of the matter is, when you compare it to other countries, the UK is one of the most successful examples of a multiracial democracy. They're almost bitterly disappointed when they're presented with such data, which tells you a lot about their mindset.
It really does. And it seems to be something that the Labour Party in particular struggles with, you know, because as the Labour Party, as you and I have spoken about before, sort of loses parts of the country that it formerly used to expect to own, like Scotland, like the north of England, which were intrinsically white working class voters. Is it the case now that they're kind of pivoting to what you might regard as the ethnic minority vote?
Well, Mike, I make the point. I find the phrase ethnic minority vote deeply problematic. You'll see that within different ethnic minority groups, voting patterns are different. There is a great deal of variation.
Right.
So I think the problem that Labour have is that they, you know, it's well documented that Labour lost a significant amount of traditional working class support in Northern England, the provincial Midlands, parts of Wales. I think what they really need to keep our eye on alongside that is they are beginning to lose support amongst what I would consider to be middle class, aspirational, ethnic minority voters, usually of Indian origin, who, quite frankly, they would have seen the kind of hectoring experienced by the Home Secretary, who is of a Gujarati Hindu origin. And they will think, you know, they will think that the direction that the Labour Party is going in, where they don't talk much about family values, personal responsibility, and all too often they indulge what I'd consider to be a tribal form of racial identity politics, which they do not want to associate themselves with. I think that you will see a further fraying of party voter relations between Labour and what I would consider to be aspirational middle-class voters of British Indian origin.
Yes. I mean, it is interesting, isn't it, that there are those on the left who do not make those differences that you've just made and that just sort of assume that everybody reacts the same way politically, which, of course, is very, very far from the truth.
Absolutely. Well, for example, we're often fed these homogenising narratives, the black community, the black community is essentially, you know, very disappointed in the way the police has behaved in recent times. They have a lack of trust in their local police force. Now, what's very interesting is when you look, when you provide a more granular analysis of attitudes within the broader British black population, you'll see that the recent crime survey in England and Wales showed that people of black African origin are more likely to have confidence in their local police force than white British people.
Mm.
So 76% of 76% of people of black African origin have confidence in their local police force. The corresponding figure for people of black Caribbean origin is 56%. So you can see that even within the broader black British population, there's huge differences between people of black Caribbean origin and black African origin when it comes to attitudes towards the police and also broader attitudes towards Parliament and their satisfaction with the way the British democratic system works.
Yes.
And the left is, all that many people on the left do, they want to completely ignore that. They want to carry on with these narratives where they put together very different non-white ethnic groups as long as it fits in neatly with their own personal political agenda.
Right. And you've been critical of the government this week as well, Rakib, about their kind of failure to clamp down in terms of law and order, allowing the police to sort of basically take a step back, not only in Bristol, but in London as well, where there were kind of mobs running riot whenever they wanted to, effectively at various different times. It seems this morning as though they found themselves a bit of a Tory backbone, if you like, and they've announced that basically they will fast track any violent protesters straight to prison within 24 hours. So
24 hours,
would you see that as a step in the right direction?
Well, it's a step in the right direction. I think that the one thing that many people would expect from a Conservative government is to robustly push back on what many see as a form of metropolitan left cultural overreach.
Yeah.
I think we've seen much of that over the course of the past week, where people do not have much respect for the rule of law and would rather seek the social change that they want to see, not through democratic means. Now, ultimately, we do live in a liberal democratic society. There are channels there that can be pursued to, you know, to facilitate the kind of social change that people would like to see from a personal perspective. What I would say about the Conservative government is that when it comes to issues of law and order, people have their expectations. And it's very interesting that you probably have a number of traditional minded voters in the Red Wall, which these are voters who used to previously vote for the Labour Party.
Yeah.
Now probably thinking that, hang on a minute, I've let my vote to facilitate Brexit. I'd expected that the Conservative administration would probably be more in line with me on issues and law and order. And they'd probably be quite disappointed by what I would consider to be government absence in light of what's happened in the past week or so.
Yes, I think that's absolutely right. Well, maybe, as I say, Dr. Rakib, we will see a change in policy from this government, because it's very clear that they had to do something. It remains to be seen whether Black Lives Matters is going to cancel all the activities they had planned for this weekend. We're going to be talking to an activist from Black Lives Matters coming up a little bit later on in the show. But, of course, we'll be hearing from more of you as well. 0344 499 1000.